Good evening. I'm Norman Robinson. Thank you for joining us for this special Sunday night commitment 2012 hot seat debate. Tonight, we'll hear from some of the candidates running for the open at large seat on the New Orleans City Council. Here are the rules. No opening or closing statements. I'll ask questions submitted by viewers and some of my own. Each candidate will also have an opportunity to ask one another a question or one other candidate a question. All answers are limited to 1 minute. When time is up, a bell will ring. Just like that. But even so, you'll be allowed to finish your thoughts, candidate, so that you're not cut off in mid-sentence. The debate will conclude with a rapid-fire round where the answers will hopefully be limited to yes or no. The candidates participating in tonight's debate are Republican Andrew Gressett, Democrat Stacey Head, Democrat Cynthia Willard-Lewis, and Democrat Austin Bedon. We begin with a few viewer questions, so let's get right to it. Viewer question one, what would you do to slow the apparent rise in crime? Are there other options besides federal agents and soldiers? Begin with Mr. Gressett.
Thank you. Probably the best thing we could do is to increase the activity in the hot spots by the qualified police and agencies that are about to come in from the federal government. I think that's probably the short-term fastest thing we can do. The type of behavior that is causing the murder rate to be what it is today is a long-term problem and needs to be addressed in various different fashions. But for the short term, and in order to get an immediate result, I think activity, more patrols, with the cooperation of the other agencies and those who are able to do that.
Ms. Head?
I would agree largely with what Mr. Gressett said. We have got to have an increased presence of NOPD on our streets. Now, we can do that in two ways immediately. With increasing the reserve officers, there are many citizens who really would like to serve 24 or 48 hours a month to do things like crowd control so that our officers could really focus on violent crime. In addition, we should increase overtime right now and, of course, increase our recruiting efforts so that we get highly qualified police officers. But we can't just add more police officers without focusing on in-service training and also better training of new recruits. That can be done easily with more work from the police monitor, as well as bringing in federal agencies such as the FBI to do that training.
Ms. Willard-Lewis.
Number one, expand the consent decree beyond administrative oversight into real depth in the ground, in the neighborhoods, coordination with assets such as DEA, ATF, making sure that at every crime scene, we have skilled and trained, knowledgeable folks who will support our police men and women. Secondly, we have to deal with better training for our young police officers, making sure that the strategy of community policing, such as what Chief Pennington brought in when we had a epidemic of crime is realized, and that we have well-trained officers in every neighborhood and on every street corner of our city. Next, we need to stop the bleeding with looking at appropriate pay raises for the increases that have brought about better-trained police officers. And then we also need to deal with redirecting the talents of our young people beyond midnight basketball. We need to deal with programs and strategies that get them gainfully employed with creative outlets for their talent, for their energies, and directing them to entrepreneurial endeavors.
Thank you. Mr. Bedon.
Well, Norman, we've lost about 250 to 300 officers over the last 1.5 years, which is a 13% decrease. The murder rate in this city has gone up by 14%. So as you know, I've asked for the Louisiana National Guard to come in and help to augment what the NOPD is doing by providing more assistance and also to give them more quick response team and also background as far as help on the ground and boots on the ground. Now, I want the Louisiana National Guard, which are already here. They're right in Jacksonville.
You know, the viewer has asked the question, are there other options besides federal agents and soldiers?
Right. And so also, to answer that question, what the mayor has done, which I applaud, has brought in the federal agencies that have come in right now to be able to help with the crime problem. Also, what I would like to see happen is that memorandums of understanding be instituted with all of the other police agencies throughout the area to be able to help with the NOPD and also to increase patrols. But we have to address the recidivism rate. We have to address the drug abuse rate. We have to address parents who allow their children to just roam the streets. And the other thing that we have to address is the mental health capabilities in the cities.
Thank you. Ms. Head, the second viewer question goes to you first. The viewer says, as a utility regulator, what is your plan to lower our bills, especially electricity in New Orleans?
Well, we have had some very exciting developments in the regulation of Entergy over the last 6 years. And that's been focusing on the demand side as opposed to just the production side. One of the problems is that we have, as a society, always just built more generation ability rather than trying to reduce the demand. So the City Council, as the regulator of energy, put forward two very specific programs to increase energy efficiency and to do it in a scientific way to test in low-income households, in moderate-income households, and in very large houses to see what kind of energy efficiency programs, what type of weather stripping, what type of modifications will change a person's usage. And then that alone will keep us out of the peak time of energy usage in the summer when it's so hot and everyone has their air conditioner on. If we can avoid going to those peak usage times and buying the most expensive power, then we're really doing a lot better as far as levelizing our bills throughout the year.
Thank you. Ms. Willard-Lewis.
I was very honored to work on the council and the utility committee when we enjoyed some of the largest settlements and we were able to offer relief to our ratepayers because it's about fair, affordable rates so that all of our citizens can have the comfort that they deserve and the reliability of energy that they reserve. But specifically, what we must push for is access to greener, more healthier living for all of our families. And so that means we've got to deal with quality construction protocols and practices. And again, we've got to deal with energy efficiency protocols and practices. And in some instances, we need to support community groups that go out and help the elderly and help the disadvantaged to make sure that everyone has access to greener, sustainable, comfortable, and healthier living. In addition to that, we need to go to Washington, D.C., and just as relief is offered for cities and for municipalities that get help with the weather in the winter, there needs to be a sensitivity to offering relief to communities that have to deal with undue heat in the summer. And we need to make sure that it's equitable and it's fair for the North as well as the South.
Thank you, Mr. Bidon.
Well, one of the first things that we have to do is we have to educate our people as to how they could conserve energy, how they could better weatherize their homes in the winter as well as in the summer, how they could utilize the new technology that is available to better give to give them better return on their investment with their energy bills. We also have to explore a lot of the new technology such as solar power as well as wind turbines and also the turbines that could be put into the river to capture a lot of energy, which will help augment what we already have. And the other thing I would also explore is creating incentives, and that's what legislators do at the municipal level as well as the state level, create incentives, to tax incentives that would be able to give people certain breaks on their taxes if they utilize these programs.
Thank you. Mr. Gresset.
Well, exciting developments is not the way that I would define what's happening with Entergy. As a matter of fact, I guess Entergy is excited because every time they go to the city council, they get what they want. They get a rate increase. And the first thing you do is you put a freeze on a rate increase. The second thing you do, we hire, and you have to look at the contract. It is done by contract. Washington, D.C. law firms, we are required to hire a certain number of local minority attorneys. Jeff Wilkerson was one for many years, did a fabulous job. The first thing we need to do is get the contract that shows what the city council is required to do on behalf of the citizens, because information is not there. We need to let the public know. We need to add sunshine to the city council. As a matter of fact, Arnie Philco was working on a proposal so that all professional service contracts be awarded in the council chamber in front of the camera. And that's the sort of thing we need to do.
Thank you. Ms. Willard-Lewis, the third viewer question goes to you first. And the viewer number three wants to know, as an at-large council member, you represent the entire city. How is it possible to keep everyone's best interests in mind with so many unique neighborhoods to consider?
Well, certainly, I think that the unique characteristic of all of our neighborhoods is what makes New Orleans the most interesting city in the entire world. As a matter of fact, Charles Kraut defines unique next to New Orleans. Let me just say that having lived in so many parts of our city, having been a New Orleans girl all my life, fourth generation New Orleanian with a family raised in New Orleans, I understand the unique assets of all of our neighborhoods and will work to deal with those transformative projects that will really define and uphold the strengths of all of our neighborhoods, whether it's West Bank, whether it's Lower Nine, or whether it's downtown. We will push for those economic development trigger projects that can catalyze and stabilize the workforce in our city, give opportunities to our small businessmen and middle class businessmen and women and our young people, because it's about making our people strong. And I think the critical approach is to deal with the economics of those neighborhoods.
Thank you, Mr. Badon.
I've lived in different parts of the city, and we have a wonderful city, beautiful city. Every part of this city is equally as important as the next. No one's part of the city is any better or any worse than the next. So as your councilman at large, what I'm going to do is hold town hall meetings throughout the entire city, because I want to be able to hear what the people are saying and address all of their needs. I have often said that when people call the council office, they get the runaround, because what happens is they get pushed to their district councilman. I'm not going to do that. There are three people who represent everyone within this city. It's the two at-large members and the district council person. And if any one of my staff were to say, did you check with your district councilman first, they'll be fired. Because I want to represent the entire city. I want to make sure that every need is addressed, and they, the people, realize that they have a friendly ear with my council office, and I will do everything I can to help them to succeed in and make their goals.
Thank you, Mr. Gressett.
Your obligation to the citizens of New Orleans as a council person at large is to represent everyone in the city with a modicum of respect and to listen to everyone equally and fairly and give everyone an opportunity to voice their concerns. No matter what neighborhood you're in, uptown, downtown, East Bank, West Bank, that is your obligation to engage in professional behavior, professional conduct. There will be disagreements, but unique is the key word to the question, and we are a unique city. We are, as a native New Orleanian, we are one of the most beautiful cities in the world. So I believe that listening to the constituents and the citizens of New Orleans is probably the best thing you could do as their elected representative citywide. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Head?
The reality is every citizen of New Orleans wants the same thing. Every neighborhood wants the same thing. You want a safe place for your kids to ride bikes. You want crime control. You want decent, equitable delivery of public services. In District B, we're sort of a microcosm of the city. We have the very wealthy and the very poor. We have downtown, very urban areas, and we have more spread out communities uptown and more toward mid-city. And the partnerships that we've been able to develop in District B have elevated communities that have been ignored for so very long. To be honest, most of my time has been spent working hard on those communities that needed it the most. The Garden District often has what they need and the advocacy that they need. But Central City didn't have that before we started working with the community to help their voices be empowered. And that's what I'd like to bring throughout the city, is diligent work, a tenacity to try to recreate some of the successes we've had in District B so that people can walk to, if necessary, commercial corridors to get what they need for their life.
Thank you, candidates. So far, so good. I'm sure the viewers appreciate your effort to answer their questions. We pause now for our first break, but when we come back, the candidates will get to ask each other questions. Don't go far.